Thank you, Rick. Well, that last trailer of a movie was really moving. I'm happy to see these things. Let me start by saying that it is indeed an honor for me to be present here amongst all of you at this very important conference. Indeed, I'm privileged to deliver the plenary address at this opening ceremony on an issue which is very close to me and my heart. I'm thankful to the Harm Reduction International, especially my very old friend Rick Lyons. I still remember meeting him in London, where he gave me a pep talk on a number of issues, for inviting me to present this address. I also want to thank the local organizers in Kuala Lumpur, the Malaysian AIDS Council, for the generous hospitality that I have experienced since I arrived in Kuala Lumpur yesterday morning. I was also privileged to meet people who used drugs yesterday, who gave us an idea of the problems in Malaysia. Let me also thank the Honorable Minister of Health of Malaysia, YB Datuk Seri Dr. S. Subramaniam, for being present here and to engage, and his promise to engage further in deliberations about the issue of drug use, and I may note, and he made that clear, to engage with the people who use drugs in the policy that is to come in the future in Malaysia. It is indeed important that communities and persons working for drug users, people using drugs, must be engaged in the dialogue. That was the reason that the Malaysian government was able to change its policies in harm reduction and provide leadership in the region. It is indeed appropriate that the 24th International Harm Reduction Conference is being held in Malaysia, which embraced harm reduction services for people who inject drugs. And on this, I must acknowledge the leadership of my very close friend, Dr. Ariba Kamarazam, and of course, Dr. Raj Karim. Hopefully, this conference will allow us in the Asian region an opportunity to critically examine the laws, policies, and practices in vogue today in our region, reflect on them, and consider what we should do at the UNGAS, which will debate the issue in April 2016. The UNGAS initiative was taken by the Latin American countries to make corrections to, let me make it very clear, disastrous laws, policies, and practices relating to drug use internationally and domestically, and which affects all people, not only people using drugs, but everybody in a very adverse way. Since we're in Asia, let me say that traditionally in our region, drugs such as opium, cannabis, kratom, khat, and other drugs have been used traditionally for medical, religious, or cultural purposes. For example, opium was used for medical purposes across Asia, from Persia to China, including Indonesia. In Persia, Avicenna's treatise, Canon on Medicines, discusses the therapeutic use of opium extensively. Smoking it with tobacco as madak became common in China, particularly in ritualistic and social gatherings. Cannabis, too, has been used for hundreds of years in Asia, particularly in India, where it has been described by one of our parliamentarians as a way of life. Besides being a medicine, in indigenous medical systems such as Ayurveda, Tibetan medicines, and Chinese medicine. Kratom has been used traditionally both in Thailand and Malaysia for medicinal purposes, cultural, and other purposes. I was informed yesterday that there was an attempt to ban kratom. Fortunately, that did not succeed. Similar cultural practices existed in South America amongst native communities, particularly relating to drugs like coca. The present laws, policies, and practices the world over are a product and mandated by the UN conventions of 61, 71, and 88. However, their origins lie in the 19th century notions among moral and evangelical groups about the use of opium and cannabis in the erstwhile colonies. Whose lobbying amongst governments and international organizations culminated in universal drug prohibition. This was despite, let it be noted, the findings of the Opium and Hemp Commission in the late 19th century that mild and moderate use of these substances is not deleterious to health. However, the prejudice of Western moralists and evangelists against local practices was so much that the therapeutic benefits of cannabis, for example, were not acknowledged in modern medicine for a long time. It is therefore ironic that countries in Europe and North America are now rediscovering, as it were, the medical use of cannabis and even changing their laws to allow medical dispensation, whereas our traditional medical practices are lost on our governments. I have no hesitation in saying that for societies in Asia, drug prohibition is a historic wrong which needs to be corrected. Significantly, all the three drug conventions recognize that their primary objective is protecting the health and welfare. They use the word mankind, but I'm using humankind. Surely the measure of success of these policies adopted pursuant to these conventions should be judged on health and human indices. Unfortunately, evaluation of drug policies is done on the basis of enforcement measures, the number of seizures, the amount of seizures, numbers of persons arrested and convicted. This is because conventions mandate criminalization of activities relating to narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances, including cultivation, manufacture, trade and transport, and more particularly, the use and possession of drugs outside the medical and scientific use. All the evidence shows that while seizures of drugs and arrests and incarcerations have increased over the years, yet the world has not become drug-free. While short-term successes may have been achieved, the long-term effect is actually producing a stimulus to illicit drug production. Illegal drug manufacture and use is simply increasing. Thus, for example, global opium production has doubled every decade, 1,200 tons in 1971, 2,600 tons in 87, 4,800 tons in 1997, and predicted to be 40,000 tons in 2027. The inevitable conclusion is that the prohibitionist drug laws, policies, and practices have simply failed to achieve the objective of a drug-free world or getting rid of drug addiction. However, the irony is that most public servants, be it police or judges, believe that they are doing the right thing by arresting and jailing person for using drugs. Let me tell you, recently I was arguing a case of a person, a Japanese young person in India, who was arrested and convicted for possessing cannabis. When I argued the matter in the Supreme Court, the judge's reaction was, cannabis. Well, I'm sorry, we are not going to entertain your appeal. That's the prejudice in most societies amongst the establishment. According to some authors, the failure of war on drug strategy is because of the failure to appreciate the market dynamics of drug production, the establishment, and that of increasing demand. This view, in my view, rightly argues that in the 18th century, opium was transformed from a luxury commodity to a commodity of mass consumption, just like coffee and tobacco. Over the last 200 years, opium has emerged as a major global commodity, similar to other stimulants, such as coffee and tea. And I would like to add alcohol and tobacco. Suppression of demand operates like the application of a pressure on a balloon. You squeeze one part of the inflated balloon, it'll bulge on the other side. This is exactly what is happening in the war on drugs, where suppression of drugs in one region leads to the emergence of production and supply in other regions, and more so, as also the emergence of new psychoactive substances which are impossible to control. Pertinently, the prohibitionist regime spawned criminal syndicates and gangs who thrive on exorbitant profits to be made because the drugs are illegal and because the illegal market operates. Prohibition has also been responsible for trade shifting from opium to heroin and from opium smoking to injecting heroin and the consequential transmission of communicable diseases including HIV and hepatitis B and C. If one were to evaluate the prohibitionist regime in terms of health and welfare of mankind, which is its primary objective, the failure of the war on drugs is even more compounded. Criminalization results in the incarceration of large number of people for drugs-related offenses. In a number of countries, nearly half or more of the prison population comprises drug users. Apart from the fact that it's quite a burden on the taxpayers to maintain prisoners, drug users do not have any access to the preventive and treatment health services like needle syringe and OST. The already high prevalence of hepatitis C and HIV amongst drug users in prisons is only exacerbated. Harm reduction, promoting and making available an accessible needle syringe and other facilities are well-known evidence-based methods known to reduce risk of transmission of communicable diseases like HIV and HCV. Similarly, evidence-based treatment for drug dependence, namely buprenorphine substitution and methadone maintenance or opioid substitution therapy, is well known. Thankfully, because of the HIV epidemic, a number of developing countries with a significant push from UNAIDS and the Global Fund on TB, HIV, and Malaria were able to provide harm reduction and OST services for IDUs in safe havens. Thus, in most Asian countries, harm reduction and OST service do exist for IDUs. However, in most of them, they have not been scaled up and are not made accessible to the people who really need them. As criminalization of drug use persists in some of the countries, and most of them rather, drug users are stigmatized. Not all of them are able to access harm reduction services. This increases the risk of transmission of communicable diseases. Thus, levels of seroprevalence of HIV and hepatitis C is very high amongst injecting drug users in developing Asian countries compared to, say, developed countries, for example, Australia. The position for hepatitis C is much worse than HIV. While governments across the world were constrained to introduce harm reduction services because of the HIV epidemic, with the waning of HIV, which is no longer an issue in a country like India, there is a real danger that such services may not be available in the future to drug users in such countries. This is going to be exacerbated by the withdrawal of the Global Fund from middle-income countries who will not be able to have the money to provide such services. This is a matter of urgent concern. While HIV has been addressed in the past, hepatitis C, a larger and a rising epidemic, has been completely ignored in the developing countries. And this actually afflicts injecting drug users the most. This is because we have seen the problem from the perspective of the disease in a silo and not holistically addressing the problem of the drug user or the patient comprehensively. The routes of transmission for HIV and Hep C are very similar, but Hep C is more transmissible than HIV. However, seroprevalence of HIV is over 4 times higher than HIV. Vulnerable groups, particularly people who use drugs, are co-infected with HIV and TB and now with HCV. There's an urgent need to address hepatitis C epidemic and make available not only facilities for testing, but also make treatment available for those people. Fortunately, now with the advent of new and better drugs, hepatitis C is completely curable across genotypes within a short period of time. The traditional treatment of pegylated interferon with ribavirin, to which not all genotypes respond positively, is now superseded by treatment of direct antivirals, amongst them sofosbuvir, dacarbazine, and adipocevir. With a combination of all these drugs, all genotypes can be cured. However, The drugs are prohibitively expensive. Sofosbuvir is available in the US at $84,000 for a course of treatment. In India, multinational drug maker Gilead has entered into voluntary licensing arrangements or agreements with Indian generic companies with restrictive conditions. Significantly, they don't allow export of those drugs to high-burden hepatitis C countries like those in Latin America, the MENA region, Central Asia, Eastern Europe, and Southeast Asia. The availability of medicines from Indian generic companies to those in the developing world, which was taken for granted in the HIV era, is now under threat, particularly in the context of hepatitis C. This is a major problem which has to be addressed by treatment activists. That apart, in some countries in the region, treatment that is administered to people using drugs on the basis that all of them are drug-dependent persons and not based on OST, which is evidence-based. Authorities in the region resort to compulsory detention and treatment programs of persons who are allegedly drug-dependent. Firstly, there is no scientific basis of determination of drug dependence in these countries in their laws. Only urine analyses are resorted to. Thus, even persons who are not drug dependent are forced into compulsory detention centers. Sometimes these are accompanied by punishment, sometimes by forced unpaid labor, solitary confinement, and even experimental treatment without consent. A vast majority of drug users who pass through such compulsory detention centers return to drug use after the period of compulsory detention and the so-called detoxification programs. As the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health, I reviewed these practices of compulsory drug treatment centers and found them incompatible with, and indeed in violation of, the right to health enshrined in the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. The punitive approach to drug use has resulted in a large number of countries, numbering about 33, out of which a large number are in our region, resorting to death penalty for certain drug-related offenses. Apart from the fact that death penalty does not achieve its stated objective of deterrence, resorting to it for drug-related offenses is contrary to international law, which mandates, first, the progressive reduction of capital crimes aimed at the abolition of death penalty, and secondly, and more importantly, restricting it to the most serious of crimes, such as those that result in the death of another person. International law does not recognize drug offenses as the most serious crimes. Unfortunately, despite that, that death penalty continues to be used in a number of countries. Moreover, about 10 countries have mandatory death penalty for drug-related offenses, again, a majority in the Asian region. In constitutional jurisprudence, mandatory death penalty has no place as it takes away the judicial discretion in sentencing. The other very serious and deleterious consequence of criminalization of drug use is that millions of people worldwide who require essential medicines for treatment and palliative care are unable to access them. Excessive restrictions and sanctions imposed by law instills fear in the medical community of falling foul of the law. This results in the lack of availability and accessibility of drugs like morphine, required as a painkiller for patients suffering extreme pain in the terminal stages of cancer and HIV. The lack of access is particularly acute in developing countries. Now, the most common used anesthetic, ketamine, is also sought to be included as a restrictive substance internationally. Significantly, over 90% of all the legally controlled medicines are consumed in North America and Europe. As a result, over 70%, some say even 90% of the patients in developing countries who require such essential medicines do not have access to such medicines. Tomorrow, the Global Commission on Drug Policy is releasing a report on this issue, and I hope you'll be able to access that report and find out more about that. While all these are serious and unfortunate consequences of drug prohibition, the most profound impact, and I speak this from a personal experience interacting with my clients, the most profound impact of criminalization is an impairing and impinging on the dignity of people who use drugs. Seen as morally depraved and blameworthy, the people who use drugs are treated less than human, undeserving of respect, rights, and opportunities. Not only do others, state and society, treat people who use drugs with contempt, sometimes they themselves imbibe these values of unworthiness and denigrate themselves. Nothing can be more sadder than that. So what is the way forward? This conference, in the context of UNGAS in April 2016 in New York, is an opportune moment for all of us, particularly the activists, particularly the people who use drugs and who are here, to dialogue with the government, to take the issue forward and propose necessary changes in the laws, policies, and practices which exist not only in our own countries, but all over the world. First of all, as the Global Commission has mentioned, there must be a debate on these vital issues beyond, if I may say so, of harm reduction. In all circles, political, legal, and social. Secondly, the fundamental premise of any response has to be that the people who use drugs must be accorded all respect and dignity and be treated without discrimination. Third, there must be a recognition that the strategy which has been used till today, the so-called war on drugs, has completely failed and has had disastrous consequences on the health and welfare of humankind. Unfortunately, in our region, the recent ASEAN ministers' meeting failed to acknowledge this and announced that the flawed prohibitionist policies must continue. It is our duty as activists to engage in a dialogue with our respective governments to change that point of view. Fortunately, there are winds of change. The United States, which initiated and has been in the leadership on the war on drugs, is seeing those very changes. A number of states there have seen the futility of those and started legalizing the use of marijuana. The response, again, must be based on the primary objective of the conventions, that is the health and welfare of humankind, and on the right to the health framework enshrined in Article 12 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, which mandates that health, good services, and facilities be made available, accessible, and be of good quality, and be available and accessible without discrimination. The punitive regimes of drug laws must be replaced with regulatory measures. If we can deal this with alcohol and tobacco, there is no reason why we cannot do this for other drugs. Please appreciate that for tobacco, which is very, very harmful, smoking it, there is a framework convention on tobacco control, which actually says that you should educate people not to smoke tobacco or not to chew tobacco. Why can't we have that for other drugs? As you remember, I mentioned early on in the last century, the Indian Hemp Commission, a British government body, said that mild and moderate use of opium and cannabis is like alcohol. So why can't we have a regulatory system? Health goods and facilities and services must be made available and accessible without any discrimination. Preventative and treatment services, including harm reduction, must be again made available without discrimination. And most importantly, and this is my respectful submission, death penalty for drug-related offenses must go. It has no place in a civilized society. This can be the basis of discussions with our respective governments. They may not agree with us today, but the persistence and the determination of our activists, our comrades, who are working and who are people using drugs, their passion, their courage and determination, like Robert Bruce, will knock on the heads of the governments and change their policy in time to come. I'm sure that these policies will change. Never give up hope. In the era of HIV epidemic, we learned that the rights-based approach works. The key component of that strategy was the involvement of the affected communities in shaping the response. It is my respectful submission that it is our duty here and now to learn what we can, go back to our respective countries and inform and have a dialogue with the government and tell them nothing about us without us and change their policies towards drug use. I've learned that we can change laws, policies, and practices on a number of issues if we are passionate about our cause. And I've seen the passion and determination amongst the persons who received the awards. I know you can do it, and don't give up. Thank you very much.